My name's Sean Murphy. I'm with the Associated Press. I'm just going to run down what I basically witnessed. There were five media witnesses, obviously. There were also two women from the Federal Public Defender's Office, and then the governor's cabinet secretary for public safety, Tricia Evers, was also in with us. I also saw Dr. Urban Yen enter and sit behind us with the victim's family. So the curtain was raised at 10 a.m. Right on time, and Coddington was asked if he had any last words, and he said, "Yes, sir, to all my family and friends, lawyers, everyone who's been around me and loved me, thank you." And he listed off the names of several people and said, "I love you all." He said, "You gave me 2 years of complete love and happiness." I'm not certain who he said that to. He also said, "Governor Stitt, I don't blame you and I forgive you." He thanked his attorney, Emma Rolls, and said, "I love you." And then he was asked if that was the conclusion of his remarks, and he said, "That's it, sir." Then the execution began at about 10:01. He looked over at his lawyer a number of times, gave a thumbs up. He appeared at 10:03. He appeared to be talking. The mic was cut off, so we couldn't hear what he was saying. His lips were moving, and his eyes were blinking. 10:04, his cheeks began to flutter a bit. He exhaled heavily a couple of times, and his chest kind of hitched or heaved several times. 10:05, his eyelids began to droop. 10:06, his chest was still moving. The doctor came in at about 10:07 to do the consciousness check, and I saw him shake Mr. Coddington. At 10:08, he was declared unconscious. We could hear him snoring because they turned the mic on to announce that he was unconscious. 10:08, his chest was still moving. 10:09, his breathing became more labored. And then around 10:09, he appeared to stop breathing. 10:13, his face kind of became a darker color. He wasn't breathing at this point. His mouth and his eyes were slightly open. Doctor entered at 10:15, checked for a heartbeat and flashed a light in his eyes. And then Director Crowe came in and pronounced him dead at 10:16. So, any questions? Yeah, I think so. I think with the midazolam that you see that labored breathing, you see the chest kind of hitch or heave a little bit. It wasn't it wasn't a dramatic heave where his body came up. Just you could just kind of tell the breathing was labored. But I would think that it's pretty par for the course of a midazolam execution. Okay.
Nolan Clay from the Oklahoman.
Thank you, Sean. Relayed the times pretty well. We went over them. Don Heath was the spiritual advisor. He was had a suit on. He had a white stole or shawl. He read from a Bible. He stood at inmates. By the inmate's side at his feet. There was another corrections officer in there to watch him. That officer was masked, but there wasn't any problem. At one point, inmate Coddington said some things and Heath nodded in agreement. I saw Emma Rolls, his attorney. She was on the front row. She was crying a lot, and but she, I saw her mouth something like "I love you" to him, and that's when he kind of gave the thumbs up. Dr. Yen's been there for three other executions. the last time I saw him in there, he was in the row with us. This time he was in the back. The breathing was somewhat more labored than the other two modern executions I've seen, but it was, as Sean said, it wasn't dramatically labored, and I didn't see any real issues.
How do you describe Connington's emotions?
Well, that is a good question, because we kind of expected from how remorseful that he was at his clemency hearing that we would see some expression of remorse. We didn't at all. It was the statements were "I love you," the family and friends, the reference to Angela, which we took was his fiance or girlfriend. He referenced his attorney. He never once said anything about the crime or, but he spoke in of a loud voice. He wasn't hard to hear. He looked up most of the time. And, you know, when he said, when they asked him if that was it, he said, "That's it, sir," you know, assertively. And, but I was surprised I didn't hear any expressions of remorse, because we kind of expected that. Any other questions?
Next, we'll hear from Amanda Gilbert from Fox 23.
And it's Amanda and then Gilbert, Gilbert. One thing I wanted to bring up, Emma Rolls, his lawyer, was visibly upset, I'd say even before things started. She had tears in her eyes, definitely most of the, if not all of the time this happened. Everything started on time, and then the speech that Coddington gave, I would say it lasted about a minute, almost a minute, around 10:01. One thing I will add to the speech, I believe the very last thing Coddington said before he was done was, "Angela, it's fabulous. I love you." We believe Angela is someone he knew during his time in prison, possibly a girlfriend. We don't have that confirmed. But again, yeah, he said, "Angela, it's fabulous. I love you." And that was one of the last things he said. Then he spoke with his spiritual advisor. I will say during that time, Coddington seemed to focus a lot of his time on his lawyer, Emma. They definitely looked at each other a lot. He wiggled his fingers at Emma and gave her a thumbs up at one point, and that almost seemed to be more for her, since she was obviously very upset. I would say around 10:08 is when they made sure that he was asleep, and we could hear snoring when they brought the mic back up, which, as you were saying earlier, is important because that shows us that he was breathing when he was asleep still. So that happened around 10:08. Before that time, two of us could not see the clock where it was positioned, so it was a little difficult to get times, but we also noticed eyes fluttering, that heaving at one point, that labored breathing just for a few moments. It never looked like his eyes fully closed, but I think that was just the angle we were at. And then, around 10:15, the doctor came in and checked for heartbeats, checked his pupils, and he was pronounced dead at 10:16. Nope, mostly just emotional. Definitely use the Kleenex. And
was he looking at her through the glass or through the window? I thought he couldn't see anyone on the other side.
He could see us. Yeah, he was looking at her through glass.
Mm-hmm. Did he make any eye contact with you guys?
I don't think so. He focused his attention when he looked out, which was not much, at Emma.
Augusta McDonald from KWTV 9.
Thank you. Just a few things to add from beyond what other media witnesses have already talked about. I would agree, in the first 6 or 7 minutes while he was losing consciousness. There were several kind of like heaving chests. His chest was sort of glitching as he was breathing. That was noted. His cheeks kind of puffed on exhale a few times. And he was looking over at Emma Rolls, who was sitting right in front of us at the first row. So he's kind of like looking down his body at her, making eye contact. He kind of, you know, wiggled his fingers. And she was highly upset, sitting with another staffer from the Federal Public Defender's Office. Doctor came in, shook him, checked to see if he was unconscious about 10:08. I would say, going a little out of order, the only additional thing from what we've already gone through in terms of his last words, he listed some names. He started out, "Yes, sir, to all of my family, friends, and attorneys, everyone who loved me, James, Duffy, Monica, Lily, and Latori. I love you all." He said, "You gave me 2 years of complete love and happiness." And then Governor Stitt, "I don't blame you and I forgive you." Thanked his attorney, Emma Rolls, and then listed several names: Emma, Julie, Tamara, Dawn. And then said, "Angela, it's fabulous. I love you." And then he said, "That's all." And then his last words were, "That's it, sir." And then Dawn Heath, kind of reading from the Bible, there was some interaction between Dawn and Coddington as he was laying there. He sort of, Heath was reading, Coddington was sort of, he was speaking a little bit before he was unconscious, and there seemed to be some sort of interaction we couldn't really hear. I was also in a position where I could not see a clock, so I don't have times. And then I just kind of witnessed him, his face after the second drug was administered, kind of starting to turn purple or blue near the end. So by the end, when he was declared dead at 10:16, his features were very purple and pale. They checked his eyes and his heart, and again, Scott Crowe said time of death at 10:16. Sorry?
You couldn't hear anything Don had said. He was totally muted.
No, he was muted. He was reading from the Bible. And so there was some reading, and then there were some words he said also. He was just speaking to Coddington outside of some sort of scripture.
Okay. The last media witness we'll hear from this morning is Chris Polanski from KWGS Radio.
Hey, KWGS, we're the NBR station in Tulsa. I'm Chris Polanski. I have very little to add from what everyone's already said. Shortly after the first drug was administered, I did notice I had a very good view of Mr. Coddington's, the left side of his neck. I noticed his neck tremored rather quickly for a little bit there. It continued for about a minute, maybe a little bit less. Like I believe Sean said already, at 10:09, just before 10:10, is when I clocked him as having taken his last breath. His neck at that point, I could see a pulse. I could see he continued to have a pulse, and I saw that movement stop right about a minute later at 10:11. Shortly after the Director Crowe declared the time of death and that the execution was complete, the curtain closed. We waited to be escorted out. There were some flashes from behind the curtain, which I took to be like someone taking pictures or a team taking pictures. And just a few spare details. I made exceptionally brief eye contact with Mr. Coddington right when the curtain raised, but it was, I believe, while he was looking for Emma Rolls, his attorney, who he then spent all his focus on. When the curtain raised initially, it was, Justin Ferris, Chief of Operations for DOC, and he was the one who read the death warrant while standing over Mr. Coddington. His face was uncovered. The Reverend Don Heath's face was uncovered. There was a member of the execution team in there as well, wearing kind of like a light blue balaclava, sort of ski mask kind of thing. You could just see his eyes. And the doctor, who was off in a side room, was wearing a classic doctor's white coat and a stethoscope around his neck, but when he came in, He was wearing the same sky blue balaclava. You could just make out the doctor's eyes. That's all I have.
Okay.